श्रीमती रामानुजाय मां। टुडे वी आर जुबिलेंटली सेलिब्रेटिंग द टेक्नोलॉजी डे। द डे ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी इट ब्लॉसम्ड पैरेलली विद द डे ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी। It emanated simultaneously with the day of blossoming of this cosmos. Technology, as per the definition given by the philosophy, as well as the definition that has been given by the technocrats, technicians, and modern scientists, that deals with the culmination of the pursuit and purpose of knowledge. Knowing about a thing is an information, and orderly knowing about a thing with its structure, relativity, and function and application is known as knowledge. Collection of orderly presented information is known as knowledge, and that knowledge, out of an innovative temper, if it tempts a person to bring out a reality, to bring out a change, and to implant in the society a renaissance which caters to the development of the society, either in physical, psychological, intellectual, moral, cultural, social, whatever may be the grounds. So the unit of information collected and placed that gives knowledge, and the source of blemishless, uninterrupted, focused knowledge and a faculty is known as science. So science, it deals with the disciplines. It deals with each and every entities around us, as well as the entities, the species themselves. It starts with knowing of each and everything by attention, curiosity, observation, experimentation, analysis, probe, scrutiny, etc. So this science has further two extensions. The second is the engineering, and third is the technology. Then the knowledge which is in the crude form, that is in Sanskrit we used to trifurcate these things as sadhya vishaya jnanam sadhanam siddhi. Sadhya vishaya jnana is focused knowledge on a particular thing which we want to implement for a better and broader cause. And the same thing, if it has a sadhana, it should have a tool. And the science that deals with the designing of the tools, for example, the knowledge that gives the definition and dimensions of the textile, that is a textile science, and that deals with the process of engineering, that is the promotion of the tools, are the essential systems of mechanics which are suitably meant for the operation of the execution, that is known as the engineering, and the application of the same thing. It means of productivity, augmentation in the productivity, quality, richness, upgradation, enrichment, all of these things come under technology. So think a thing properly is science, and derive a tool for making your thought implemented, that is engineering. Make use of the tool and implement it, that is known as technology. So the seed of science has its branches of engineering, which culminates into the fruit of technology. Still, technology is an unripened fruit. The ripened state, that the capacity of the fruit of technology is all around peace, happiness, and socio-economical equality. That is the use of technology. So it is the penultimate stage. Even though it may be the ultimate stage, it is the penultimate stage, and the ultimate view of the technocrats, or the ultimate destination of any technology, is to bring the fruits of universal betterment, like a peace, harmony, etc. So that is the purpose of technology. There are two groups of study. One is the primitivism, and second is the anthropological history or the genetical history. According to the scriptures, they may say that even at the time of the so-called Stone Age or the Copper Age or the Neolithic Age, Monolithic Age, persons with advanced knowledge about navigation, aircraft engineering, with palatial constructions, well designed, well dressed, well modified, well civilized, knowing even about the God, the primary of the world, they coexist. that it started with the identification of stone. The first tool taken was a stone. Then we used to define this technology in four ways. Number one, it is the knowledge of tool or craft. Tool is an independent element and craft is a compound of components made for a particular niche. So knowledge is jnana. And second is utility or usage, that is known as upayoga. And third thing is niyantrana, ability to control. And fourth thing is adapting to the environmental and contextual requirements. That is auchitya. So jnana, upayoga, auchitya, that must be blended with niyantrana, a person to control. These are the quadrilateral steps by which a person's technical nature or a faculty's technological nature is defined. You don't have any other fan facility? So this is how we define technology. And technology started with the stone, I have already told. It is known as the Aquilian stone. They used to say Aquilian stone in the period. Then with the invention of fire, there is a primitive technology. Technology day, we cannot fix any day. We can fix a day of technology as per a remarkable progress or success or after any technocrat or any successful person. Technology day, when did it start? So it started with the stone, understanding of fire, making use of the basic rudimentary tools for survival, clothing, domestication of animals, how to design the pottery, then identification of copper, then agriculture, small system of basic weaving, coloring, etc. Then the famous wheel technology, then the writing technology it came, then salt, identification of salt, then bronze, then into iron, then the sundial for direction, timing, etc. They invented new things like glasses, even they invented. And all these things they come under the primitive technology. We used to define the era of technology as primitive technology, classical technology, medieval technology, contemporary technology, modern technology, and emerging technologies, and fictional technologies which are there in suspension. This is how we classify these technologies. So apart from these technologies, we have identified a lot of things. For example, understanding of an atom, movement of electrons and their flow as electricity. There are innumerable things like communication systems, then television, all of these things, various other systems of communication, information, knowledge sharing, and various other modes that are being implemented in the society over the era of several centuries. No doubt they are having their own hallmarks and remarkable points, but still it is a never-ending perpetual journey into the unquenchable thirst of human being based on curiosity, necessity, emergency, and also the process of augmentation of the resources and the balanced methodology of preservation, conservation, reservation and distribution of the same. Now let us come to the modern systems as well as the modern schools of technology. Now basically we start with artificial intelligence. It is the advanced mechanical response of machines by which they can be replaced for human purposes and intervention. So it started with artificial intelligence. And also not only designing and engineering the other things, also self-engineering by means of chromosomal upgradation, cell culture, tissue culture, and genetic engineering, genetically modifiable things on human evolution like whole body transplant, cochlear implant, retinal implant, then artificially insulating the motors and motion particles of the body for immobility, then addition what we call, it is known as neurohacking, and there is also one more portion which is known as a brain uploading, brain gate, brain port. Innumerable things they have come in the genetic engineering. And the third thing is on transportation. There are two types of transportations. One is the earth-based transportation and second is the spatial transportation. Now recently they have the scramjets. They are of a very totally unimaginable speed level by area. Even now whatever we are using in the form of the diodes, more than that, organic light emitting diodes, OLED, OLED, organic light emitting diodes, presently they are they don't require that backing light. As they don't require the backing light, there are possibilities of higher intensity of light emission as well as with lesser heat emission, with heat resistance as well as optical clarity, having the such type of filters which are free from optical hazards for the viewers and users and promoters. Likewise, each and every area used to have number of things like meta materials. Now they have come into meta materials, more than the materials. Innumerable areas, in each and every area we are going, we are progressing. And no doubt it is the yuga, we used to call in Sanskrit, Krita Yuga, Treta Yuga, Dwapara Kali. So this yuga is nano yuga. In spite of the development of various faculties, we used to call in Sanskrit as Visheshana and Visheshya. Nanotechnology is not a different or a distinct technology. It is a Visheshana for all technologies. It is an adjective for all technologies. It is the extension of each and every element to a nanoscale. So nanotechnology is going to be the invisible partner and the predominant comrade in each and every technology that is about to come and that is being emanated now. And some roots of nanotechnology, that is the science of the Paramasukshmanu, as quoted in the scriptures, I want to just quote one or two. And in the Vyakhyana, in the definition, an elucidation given to Anoraniyan. There is a Vedic statement, Anoraniyan. So he is the God is the atomic dimension of atoms. When this is explained, it is told that the most macroscopic element or expansion is the cosmos. And atom is the basic unit. And here Anoraniyan, it defines the states of God, the subtlety of God. Whatever may be the proportion between an atom as well as a macrocosmic universe, the same proportion in the other side, in the negative integer, is between the atom and the atomic stage of God. So it is quite unimaginable. So this clearly gives an idea about the visibility of atoms, number two, subatomic particles and subsubatomic particles and intra-interatomic particles, their relativity and other things. And Vaisheshika Shastra of Kannada, especially that deals with Paramanuvada. Kannada, he propounded the theory of Vaisheshika, that is a qualified theory of creation, in which he clearly mentions about the atomic structure being the primordial and rudimentary cause for the existence, expansion, dissolution and creation of the world. And here, this Paramanuvada, it deals with a lot of like Tresanu, Mahanu, Sushmanu, it deals with a lot of atomic particles. So all of these things, they are very much understood for just apprehension of the nature of the universe, and the Western science community, which they have understood as well as applied it practically for purposes. There are two types of benefits from the atomic structure understanding of the world. One is the implemental understanding, second is the contemplative understanding. The contemplative understanding of the atomic nature of the universe as practiced by the seers, sages and the spiritual scientists of the yester years and millenniums, they have just meditated it as a spiritual process by means of which they were able to see something which we cannot see or we can see only with an instrumental aid, number one. Then the implemented portion of the same thing, which is there in practical distribution, which is being done by the scientists, that has resulted in lot of other developments that we are going to now see, also with their hazards, risk factors and methodologies for rectification and reinstallation of scientific purity and technological infallibility with prosperity and tranquility. So this nanoscience basically that deals with Anuniyantarana Shakti. We used to say in Ashtama Siddhi, the first Siddhi is Anima. Anima is of three types. One, control an atomic structure. Number two, to become an atomic structure, to convert anything into atomic structure. It is known as Anima Trikam. Anurupa Parivartanam, Anurupa Svikaranam, Anurupa Niyantaranam, Tat Anima Itya Vidhiyate. The Vidya of Anima is, because on those times, Already people, you know, that they are continuously engaged in wars, silent wars, smart wars, instigated wars, cold wars, different types of wars are there. Apart from the weapons of mass destruction, then great weapons of, divine weapons of mass destruction, if they are also coexisting with these weapons, immediately there will be total extinction of the human species. So lot of things due to the esoteric tradition and lineage, they have been hidden, forgotten, or totally being discarded by those people. So the possibility, whether it has been implemented by them or not, that is subjective to discussion, but possibility of a person attaining an atomic status and possibility of converting something to an atomic level, as well as controlling an atom and manipulating an atomic and molecular structure, is contemplated, that has been pondered, cogitated by them and clearly explained in the treatises. So the possibility is there, and this is known as the nanoscience. And the second thing is, I have already told, taking everything towards an extension of a nanoscale. There is a comparison in Shastras, Balagra Shatabhagasya Shatatha Kalpitasya Cha Tayor Bhaga Savikya Sachanantyaya Kalpite. It is not an exact arithmetical prediction or something. It is just an approximate idea which elaborates the subtlety of soul, the structure of soul. It says that you take a tip of hair, you divide it into 100 times. You take that 1 by 100 and still further you can divide it into 1 by 100 times. And in that 100 portion may be further classified and segregated, in which a portion will be the width or surface level of a life atom, that is the soul. This is what they explain. And we are confident that we cannot neither take a hair and look at the tip, but we cannot convert and we cannot segregate these things. But still, now we are having that facility, even more than that. That is an approximacy, and even accurate than that, we are having that facility. It is one, for example, if there is one nanometer, it is 1 billionth of a meter, 10 to the power of minus 9. So it is something that what science can define, describe and design. If such thing is very subtler, and subtler than the subtlest will be something which cannot be understood by science at all. So we used to say something, the optical and objective level coordination, we used to call it in understanding. In understanding any object, the optical and object level coordination, it differs. For example, if you see something below its level, you can understand only the peripherals, the apparent structure of it. If you see something equally to that level of any spirit of understanding with a scientific temper, you can see the structure, function, relativity and other things. You cannot see two things. One is ontology, second thing is teleology. Ontology is the fundamental aboriginalization of each and every element, and teleology is the purpose. Lot of things that you design as something useful, that may become useless, that may become of lesser use than what you have imagined or dreamt, and that may even give you adverse effect. Whatever that you may think to be good, that may be very evil, resulting in a catastrophic consequence. So anything looked at its own level, that is coordinate level, that is the scientist's look, and a common man's look is the below level look. And a spiritually understood or less realized personality status, that optical status, is something governed to be as primogenitorial or primeval look, by which he sees the fundamentals, and from that fundamental analysis he used to get the reflection on the creatures and creations. He used to get an idea about the creator, and that is the fundamental, that is ontology. By this ontological mission, he diverts his knowledge towards the things created. So very easily get a fullest idea of that. So that thing has been here understood by the ancient seers and preceptors. By understanding even more than that, there are two particles apart from the nanoparticle. Now there is a next yuga which is going to come. It is known as a pico. Pico, so lot of other things are yet to come. Even nanoparticles, they are not graspable, they are not traceable, they are not so easily handleable. Means we are yet to receive so many million and millions of time subtler than these materials which are going through the world. And we can clearly understand about the subtlety of God by seeing this. For example, if the subtlety of God by seeing this, for example, if you can understand, or say, God has created everything, we used to say,
we must get a basic idea of what an element is. If something is unintelligible, according to the rule of understanding an object which is unintelligible, unintelligibility or unscrutability is understood by giving exemplification of intelligible substances, and also the difference or the proportional disparity that exists between these two things. For example, if I say that you have your own mother, you know how much she loves you. And if I say that Matru Pitru Sahasraya Bhyopi Vatsala Dharam Shastram, the scriptures are having 1,000 times that type of magnanimity, benevolence and affection more than your parents, then you will get an idea. So mother is a perceptible and visible element, and the Shastras are imperceptible things. Whenever things are imperceptible, their imperceptibility is explained to an extent only by giving corresponding status exemplifications of perceptible and visible elements. Likewise, let us explain something. Carbon-carbon bond is there. That is 12 to 50 nanometers. And this double helix DNA structure is there. That is 2 nanometer. And even as something, the tip of a hair, you know how much subtle it is. That is 80,000 nanometers. Then how a nanometer will be? And nanometer, somebody they explained this also. Nanometer, it deals with the size of the nanometer. It can be compared to that of the amount of hair that grows in your face at the time taken for you to take the razor and to keep it before your face. This is how somebody explained. We cannot just keep a nanoparticle and practice this with the razor, but still it shows how minutest things are there. By understanding these things, that's how Max Planck, a famous scholar, he told two statements. One, he told, for scientists, God is at the end, and for religious people, God is at the beginning. Every religious person sees God first, then proceeds with the creation. But no religious person is doing. No religious person is seeing God, then understanding the nature. Most of the religious people, they are having religion as the shelter for their mistakes or for their problems or solutions. That is, I am talking about absolute scientists and absolute religious votaries. Absolute religious persons, they see divinity in everything, and for them the nature is more understandable than that of the scientists. And scientists, their pursuit is to see the fundamental element, God at last. That is what Max Planck told. One. Number two, I thought of God something, and I had a faith, maybe blind, it may be superstitious or it may be irrational. But after coming to know about the intricacies, complexities of the world and the beauties inside, I started loving God. So I just believed God. That is another friend. After understanding the subtleties of the universe, intricacies of universal functions, and the multitudes and the magnitudes on various dimensions, I started loving God. God means it does not be some God which you say that it is in a temple or in a farm. God is absolute phenomenon. It is an absolutic element of purity, hilarity, festivity. It is free from melancholy and it is pure eudaimonia. It is of unconditional love and mercy. It is the substratum for tranquility. And it is the unerring perennial bestower and showerer of prosperity. So that fundamental element. So this is how they define this. Number two, apart from this, there is also a history for these nanoparticles. It started with understanding of atoms and molecules, I told them. Then from the American Physical Society, Dr. Richard Feynman, in the year 1959, he dealt with what I told in ANIMA, that we can manipulate atomic and molecular structures. The same was told by the American Physical Society lecturer, Dr. Richard Feynman. He told that they can be manipulated, and the manipulation systems can be developed. And the second thing, actually, from the Tokyo Science University, Dr. Norio Taniguchi, he dealt with the understanding of atomic structures and the division of atomic particles into further subtlety. And Dr. Erik Dastas, in the year 1987, he dealt with the possibility of getting into nanoparticles by his book known as The Era of Nanotechnology. That was the first book on nanotechnology. And before getting into that nano, the position of nano. It is the status of a high visible minute system of the atomic structure and status. Before getting that merely atomic studies, molecular studies, and getting into the divisibilities, all these things were pondered and it was framed. The nomenclature, Namakarana, was given by Dr. Ehring. And later on, various things are just gradually, you know, that if something is initiated by somebody, that reflects in the curious minds of the other to deal with the same thing, to get into further depth. And they have resulted in two forms of atomic structure, which is very wonderfully matching with the process of nature. One is the srijana, the process of creation. Second is the process of construction. That is, it is not the process of the construction what we made, it is a process of a reciprocal construction. That is, a linear construction is known as creation and it is clockwise. And in a reciprocated system of construction, the second non-linear construction is also made by Siddha Purushas. They are in nanotechnology known as bottom-up methodology and top-down methodology. So you can construct nanostructures by two methods. One is taking a structure, a basic structure, and allowing the structure to construct itself. That is a phenomenon known as, it is a phenomenon of a molecular adhesion, and it is based on the phenomenon of molecular recognition. So the adhesive nature of each and every molecule with the other, which makes that to construct itself, it is based on the molecular recognition. We used to say this subtler recognition in Punya Papas. Yathadhenu sahasreshu vatso vindati mataram tatha bhuvakritam karma kartaram adhigacchati. And a person's virtues and sins, in spite of the person's availability being mingled with a very magnitude of space and mass, it can really recognize and it can adhere to the person. And it can immediately approach the person without fail, or without ambiguity, or without perplexity. That is the nature of a person's imprints, virtuous and evil imprints. Likewise, there is a recognition system among the molecules by which these basic particles, they frame to construct themselves to reach that, which is known as bottom up. And second thing is known as top down. From the top, larger machines or larger structures are taken into account. Just as I have already told about the anima, anima is not the construction process. It is the process of contraction or miniaturization by the process of either a spiritual or scientific temper, which is by a mythical power that is implanted on a device to make it in a miniaturized form. So this is something which is done in the top-down process, in which large-level machines, they are contracted, they are miniaturized to the size of a nanoscale. And nano devices, there also the nanoscience consists of two things. One is nanotechnology and second is nanomaterial. Nanomaterials, they deal with the materials which are to that nanoscale, that is 1 to 100 nanometers. This is the scale, the basic molecular structure of 1 to 100 nanoscales. They are taken for consideration in nanomaterials. They are known as nanomaterials separately. And nanotechnology is a process of not only dealing these things, but also fabricating devices which are within that size range. It is not only getting the materials, you know that there are a lot of materials. For example, your microscope is not as equal or as same as the size of a microbe. There is a microscope. The size of the microscope is not as the size of a microbe. There are, for example, there is a cell microscopy is there, then spectroscopy is there. Lot of subtler things are handled in these para-optical or supra-optical vision methodologies, in which the things seen and the size, they are not corresponding or coherent to that of the size of the machinery. But nanotechnology not only deals with the materials, but also it frames the fabrication possibility of the devices within the ambit of the size range of 1 to 100 nanometers. That is the greatest in nanotechnology. And in both of these things, we used to get two microscopes. See, if normally for cells and other tissues, we used to get microscopes. A nanoparticle is still more subtle, so it requires a special microscope. One is known as the scanning tunneling microscope, and second is known as the atomic pressure microscope. And it is having two philosophies, two major processing philosophies, and one is epitaxy, and second is lithography. Electron beam lithography and molecular beam epitaxy. So this is the nano material, and this is the nano technology, and these are all the instruments, the equipments that are handled, and these are all the process, the epitaxy and the lithography process of electron and molecular beams. So this is what we call nano technology at all. Second, now we are having a lot of things, nano, everything I have already told, this is nano yuga, that is nano tube, that is nano composite, that is nano knot, that is nano metal, that is nano bot like robot now, that is nanobotics like robotics, now a new science is emerging, it is known as nanobotics, and there is also nano food, energy based food, nano food is there, everything you can prefix anything with nano in 100 years. I could say this with confidence. For two reasons, and number one, the emergence of nanoscience clearly proves so, and number two, you are not going to question me after 100 years. So for this reason, I say that you can prefix everything with nano. We can even call nano father, nano mother, nano son, everybody. So that much, see, Ati Sarvatra Varjaya, we used to say, we used to get into both extremism, extremism of paucity, extremism of insecure abundance. There are two things. One is downtrodden paucity. The other extremism is undistributed or unevenly distributed or adverse effect oriented or disordered consequential and sequential extremity in abundance. We are having two-ended knives in the form of technology. So nanotechnology, you know that it is useful in various areas, and I want to give you some suggestions. See, generally the science of lecture, delivering lecture, that is the technology of oration, I want to say. It deals with something, for example, what is that substance? What is the history of the substance? And what are the stages crossed? What is the precaution? Where it is going to end, number five? And what are the hazards? And what is the role of the people available to think or do collectively, individually, or with instrumental aid? This is how we used to speak. Now we just give you a small idea about the applications, and more than that, we want to do something for the society in nanotechnology, for which some tips are here. It is based on, first it is based on a person, you see, each and everybody, you know that the health is the most sweetest thing for people. They are interested in everything, and what they relish the most is, number one, health. I told in one health conference that God laughed at human beings for one reason. When it was asked what, simply God told, first half of your life, you are spending everything from your health for getting money. The second half, you are spending all money for restoring your health back. So likewise, health is the very basic thing. Everybody is, at least conceptively, whether they are behaving like that or not, they deserve or not, they are desiring anti-aging, youth and dynamism, then a panacea for all of the diseases, to be devoid of deficits and other deviations, and always also a sound mind and a sharp intellect. Then extended longevity, whether they are going to be useful for the society, at least for the family or not. So these are the common desires of each and every person. So nanomedicine, now see, nano, we cannot just put one nano. If it is nanomedicine, nanophysics, nanochemistry is there, nanobiotechnology is there, and nanotechnology and plants are there. I have already told about nano information technology, nano is there. So we are going to explain it very briefly. So first, it is very much available for imaging. The already available structures in cell imaging as well as the diagnostic images, they were not so clear and transparent because of the contrast level variation, due to which an invasive biopsy, you know that now there is invasive biopsy in cancer. Invasive biopsy means you must penetrate inside, you must take the tissue and then get it for a biopsical reading and scrutiny. So this is unavoidable. So to avoid this biopsy, invasive biopsy, if the contrast level is boosted by the nanoparticle coating, they are capable of giving you the clear image of the person's oncological status, cancer status, its penetration, permeation, and the other areas, by which there is no need for the person's biopsy. And not only in cancer, in detection of any latent diseases, any uncompromisable, undetectable, non-cooperative, fatal diseases, the utility of nanotechnology in magnetic resonance imaging, it is very much useful. It avoids ambiguity, obscurity, and also the supplemented requirement of further biopsy or any other analytical study for ascertaining the disease. It is not required. Very clearly, very candidly, we can get the benefit, number one. Number two, now the world is researching upon digital drug drive. So instead of going inside the body, like you are having the injected material, it which travels throughout the body. It does not focus, even though it can act upon the morbid region, it directly comes to either the intravenous or the arteries and other carriers of the blood inside the body. So it takes the material and it has to travel. That sojourning can be avoided by means of a nano drug drive. It can be used as a nano drug drive. And utility of nanoparticles. Utility of nanoparticles, for example, now gold has been used. Nanoparticles of gold oxide is used for that. It is very much useful for these people to reach at the morbid region itself, which avoids pain. Unwanted pain will not be there. If it is just inserted inside, it has more efficacy, it has lesser pain and complexities. And apart from that, nanoparticles, they are also substituted. For example, we used to have calyx in Ayurveda, you know that. All heavy metals are used, which are very hazardous. Even America and Canada, they have rejected most of the Ayurvedic drugs in the pretext of having heavy metals, undissolved, indigestibly, and as well as inassimilably projected heavy metals were highly present. And so they have rejected all of these things. Likewise, the nanomaterials, as there are subtler in status. First, I want to explain the greatness of subtlety. Number one, if something is in a macro level, if it goes to the micro level, it gets more energy. The energy is at least 1 lakh times more. Subtlety enhances the capability. Subtlety enhances power of fission and fusion. Subtlety, it gives the real color. There are two things. One is the inherent quality and second thing is the processed quality. And the processed quality is of two types. Inherent processed quality and processive processed quality. Inherent quality is also processed inherent quality and inherent quality is there. For example, you are processing lot of things outside. You are processing lot of things outside. But inside the earth, if your system is constructed to a macro system, towards a macro expansion, it undergoes lot of process, not done by you, not by any artificial thing, but by the implanted engineering and productive progressive mechanism. Implanted Engineering Productive Progressive Mechanism, IEPPM. It is inbuilt with each and everything. So everything that behaves differently, distinctly and distinguishably in its nano status or in its subatomic status, it may be nano, pico, femto, octo, lot of other things, milli or micro, whatever it may be, the more it reaches, the quality, its behavior also is distinct, different and distinguishable, I already told. Let us give some examples for that. Transparent things at the nanoparticle level, they are opaque, and opaque things are transparent. This is between opaque and transparency, number one. And so many things which are just stagnate in status, just subdued in status, they are combustible in their nano level. So many things which are inert, they behave like a catalyst. Insulators, they behave like conductors. Insulators, they behave like conductors. Solid things, they behave like liquids. So I will take five examples. So opaque thing behaving like transparent, example is copper. Copper at the nano level, it is transparent. So the behavior differs, operation differs, energy differs. What we want is a driving force to bombard that energy to get into productivity. Number one, a storage device. There are four devices required. One is the bombardment device that releases that energy. And second is a storage device. And third is, you see, everything must be corresponding to the capability. Everything must have the same efficacy. You must have a very powerful bombardment. You must have a very powerful storage equipment. Number three is the application device. So the device must also be powerful. And number four thing, very dangerous thing is, the person who uses, either a scientist or a scientific community or a national community, either a power block of the nation or the world, they must be having benevolence, good mind. If they are not having good mind, benevolence, three things will happen. Number one, they will see that it is not distributed for others. Number one, they will misappropriate energy from other sources also. Number two, they will use it for destructive purposes. So four things are required for good technology, for nanotechnology especially. As it is subtle, energy is also subtle. As it is powerful, energy is also hyper-turbulent. So the impact will also be hyper-turbulent. If it is productive, it will be also hyper-turbulent. If it is destructive, it will also result in a chaos. So apart from the production machinery, storage device and the application device, the use technology. If you are not having human technology, if you are having a devilish or fiendish technology or animal technology, whatever may be the technology that is given to you, it is very dangerous. Leo Tolstoy once he said a statement, and whatever may be the technology, if the human beings are not related by love but by egoism, whatever the technology and wherever the human being try to be equivalent or hypervalent, overpower the nature, any machines, guns or whatever that is given, it is just to be observed as very dangerous toys given in the hands of children. And apart from the Shastra, they told that not only children, heavy tools, dangerous weapons in the hand of crooked personalities, thieves and murderers, climbed, defied murderers, handling dangerous toys, it is just being compared by the Shastras. Shishu hasta gatam khadgam, chora hasta gatam khadgam, unmatta hasta gatam khadgam. With a lunatic, with a small child, innocent child, an ignorant personality, a crooked mentality. So this is how we have to handle. So the nanoparticles, they require a lot of things like processing device, storage device and application areas. So this is how the nanoparticles, they behave in a different way. Copper gears like that I have already told. So that nature of transparency is used for a lot of reflectors and other things. And number two, platinum. Platinum, it behaves in a different way. For example, the element which is not a catalyst, inert in nature, that becomes a catalyst with platinum. And aluminium, that is very stagnant in nature, subdued in nature, and that behaves like a very powerful bombarder, that behaves like a combustible element. And silica, for example, gold, it behaves like a liquid when it is taken to the nanoparticular level. And silica, normally you know that it is an insulator, everybody knows, but the nanoparticular level, it's a good conductor. So at the basic level, nano level, the more you go into the sukshma jnana, you will get things revealed and you will get the fundamentals. The same thing is applied in nanotechnology also, by you get different exposure of different things. So now let me conclude the session with giving some ideas. The purpose of science and technology, that is what we call teleology, it is to see a beautiful world, now it is ugly. To see a pure world, now it is polluted. To see an integral world, now everybody is isolated with conflicts. And it has no peace, it has no beauty, it has no resources, even if they are there, they are exploited. So the purpose of this technology has been handled by two people. One is the optimist and second by the pessimist, naturally. And there are a lot of theories like the deindustrialization theory, the theory of eco-anarchism, eco-communalism, eco-feminism. So a lot of theory that came over centuries, the debate whether technology is required or not. Somebody told it must be discarded. Somebody told that it must be developed. And somebody told that it requires a semi-permeable for getting the innocuous and useful things and to discard the other things. So a lot of such things are going here and there. And the theory of positivism, that clearly says that the purpose of technology is to bring peace in the society, to improve more resources. If something is not available, create a substitute, number one. What is the purpose of technology? Five purposes. If something is not available, if you require, try to mold it. If something is available, not abundant, then abundant. Multiply it. Something is available in abundance, properly channelize and distribute it. Number four, something is available but having deficits, rectify it and upgrade its level. Something is available but that is not only sufficient, then you create alternative and substitute. These are all the basic pillars of technology. So it is there as your big brother and beloved mother to support you at the time of distress and to cultivate inside you civilization and harmony. But parallelly two technologies must develop. There are two rails of technology. That is the user and the things used. For example, if you are seeing a person growing without changing his shirt, or a shirt only being extended without the person being in growth, both of these things are very ridiculous. Likewise, not only the technology should develop, but also three people, the carriers of technology, consumers of technology, and consumers of technology, they must be spiritually, morally, culturally qualified. If they are not qualified, whatever the technology you are going to offer, that is going to give them only adverse effects resulting in dilemma, trilemma, and never-ending miseries, untold miseries for the society. So here, I want to say something. We are having golf club, then horse race club, lot of clubs are there, country club, lot of clubs are there in the society. And nanotechnology, no doubt the whole world is dependent on that, because nanotechnology, it can give you energy. And the energy has three qualities. For example, if the energy is used for nanotechnology, that is eco-friendly. That has lesser energy consumption and it gives you more energy. So not only in medicine, also in energy. In chemistry, it is used for catalysis and filtration. Water filtration and atmospheric purification, it is used. In heavy industries, it can create thin metals with lighter weight, but with more safety as well as more sturdity. It is useful for aircrafts and also transportation, for safe and fast transportation. For refineries, it can give you nano filters, nano coating materials and nano additives are there for fuels. And for combustible engines, we can get more heat resistant engines. In food, for processing food, for making food, cultivation of food, then package and safety security of the food, all things are used with the nanocomposites. And textiles, there is a coating of nano materials for making it wrinkle free and water and stain repellent. It is there with us. In cosmetics, the titanium dioxide nanoparticles are mixed to prevent the ultraviolet composition to get into us. So in cosmetics, in textiles, in drugs, in medicine, in energy, heavy industries, in computer informatics and technology system, the MBRAM, the latest MBRAM is there, that is the magnetic RAM. Along with the CPU, they are going to come with the nanoprocessors. And there is one nano logic which they are going to implement in 5 years, which is going to deal with the process of getting rid of uncertainty, ambiguity, confusions, perplexity and other logical deficiencies, replacing the Boolean logic which exists now. So it is very much useful. So we want to create a nano club. And the people, you know, that they are having already used to blame the people that they are not having proper carry selection. They are following coercive, limitative, imitative and other various methodologies which are very much insufficient. What is limitative carrier? I know only this, I will do this. Then competitive, if he can study, why can't I study? I will also study. Imitative, everybody is studying. If it is BT, I will fall in BT. If it is IT, I will fall in IT. Everything, whatever the people are, first doctor profession was considered to be great, then engineering, then mechanical engineering, now computer, then IT, now information telecommunication. So it is imitative, even distribution of science, especially in emerging technologies, we have to create a lot of people. We have to create a nano science club in each and every colleges and research centers. Each every person, these things are very simple. You just teach the children, what is the tip of your hair, what is its size, small things are there. You can teach it as, not only as a lesson, but as a fairy tale, as a fable, as a very interesting methodology, either by visual presentation or by depiction and diagrams, you can teach these things. And we have to create a nanotube structure by means of conglomerating all the available scholars, scientists and other responsible members of society. I want to say something. Nanotechnology is very much required and the whole world is going to exist only in nanotechnology, because that occupies lesser space, that has more energy, that is eco-friendly and that is hyper-efficient. So the whole world that is coming to nanotechnology only. And even in Zimbabwe, they are not so developed countries also. There was a scientific conference between the Prime Minister and the other scientists with public. They told that it is the citizens' motion, it is the citizens' mission, it is one of the citizens' companionship. They called all the citizens and gave awareness about the nanofiltration process, and they made it available for all storage and drinking water tubes and canals, available for the public. If it is not going to benefit the public, it is not going to be used. There are three races we used to say. One is the global economic success race, that is only for global economy. Second is universal fix-up, that is technology transfer and other thing. And third thing is known as a slow race, in which it develops slowly with the common citizens, catering to the desire of the common public. So number three, I want to say two ideas. Number one, you make a nano library and also a nano club. Whether you are going to create nanoparticles or not, at least more than your Naina, you also learn about the nanoparticles. Just as it is going to be the father of all modern scientific methods, it is to be learned by all people. And somebody in the International Nanotechnology Conference, somebody participating from Asia told that $255 billion have been offered by Indian government for nanotechnology development in paints and polymers and some other things, related things, not in much research. But still it has not been properly utilized, and no public society has developed industrial research, and no student community, they have evinced their academic interest in nanotechnology. It is a very pitiable thing. We have to upgrade. That is, just now we are going to ride on a bullet cart with a Mercedes Benz or a super jumbo jet. So if you are not going to rise, it is going to rule the world of two types. One, either you must be a contemporary or at least you must be a follower. The two, especially the self-reliant status of India, I want to say one thing. India must not be the follower of West at all. Getting everything from the West or getting inspiration from West is not required. Now we have a lot of people. We must create an inspiration to the West. I want the scientific community to develop first as an elementary level. Let them become scientists later. An idea of nanotechnology which we are going to use in all fields I have explained now, that must be established by a nano fans club, nano science club, nano students club, with materials available through net sources and international journal publications are there. Directory of open access journals is there. And a lot of other prototype models are also available on demand and request. We have to develop that area. And most of the people taking the engineering are taking physics or chemistry. I kindly request, at least this is the Sikh community at the time of distress. They contributed at least a son from a family, safeguarding the nation, to safeguard the scientific prestige and the dignity of our nation in the global scenario. At least we must be in parallel in speed in the race with the Western community in science, even though not as a pioneer or forerunner. For that I want each and every student community based galaxy to donate at least one student for nanoscience, nanophysics, nanomedicine, etc., and which is going to clearly result us to get our country one more having the opportunity once more being rethroned in the successful throne of global leadership and universal torch bearership. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.
Just in case.
Anything.
Any question, any doubt, one or two people.
Can you suggest a book which use the fundamentals of nanotechnologies?
Yeah.
Any book you want?
Is
a book, sir?
Now? Yeah, there are a lot of journals. Lot of books are there. The era of nanotechnology that gives the fundamental idea. The era of nanotechnology by Erich Drexler. IIT Roorkee they are having, IIT Delhi they are having, and Amity Institute they are having a school for nanotechnology. There are three major schools in India. There are lot of nanotechnology oriented companies. Dabur Pharma they are having a nanotechnology division for nanotechnology.
Anyone would like to say anything, any especially people who have come from outside, please, please, please.
In the recent past, some reports have appeared in the United States which indicate that the nanoparticles are very dangerous for human life if they are overused, because these particles are so small that they penetrate the skin. And we have some materials which are banned now because of this condition, like asbestos is one of them. Barium is one of them. Beryllium is one of them. They are all highly toxic and also carcinogenic. Now are we trying to develop another particle, nano-based particles, which may have very desirable mechanical and electrical and other thermal properties, but are they harmful to the human life? Again, we end up in another type of thing, we discover something, invent something here, which in the long run, if we overuse, may destroy the human life. What is your idea about that?
And this subject comes under the study of the control methodologies and risk factors of nanotechnology. All technologies, you must understand, there are three divisions. First, all technologies, they are having their own risks, even with electricity, even with fire, whatever may be the energy, they have their own implication. The implied dangers are also there, productivity is also there. And number two, depending upon utility, if the users, they are misdirecting it, they are getting into hazards, number two. Number third thing is very, very great thing in which your thing falls, that is improper understanding or insufficient understanding of a material, whether it could suit all. So everything must be understood at a long run base. That's what I told. Whenever you see a thing at an equi-optical status, you can see only the impending benefits. The impending benefits are interim, immediate benefits. Long-term run cannot be got in the other things except insight, which is possible only by a person's subjection or by means of any other paranatural thing. So genetically modified crops, they have come. So initially that cotton which has been produced, that created a craze among the people, and everybody modified, cultivated and used that. That created a very great loss of lives also. Their agricultural system was totally eroded. Like that, because of lack of proper understanding, misuse of things, then improper understanding and insufficient understanding of things. See, everything must be time tested, person tested and place tested. If something is used here, the same conduciveness, whether it can be adapted to all places or not, number one. Number two, if something is to a particular person, whether it is universally adaptable and assimilable by all people or not, if something is appearing to be beneficial now, does it have any impact over a long period of run? Either immediately, mediately, or remotely, or genetically, whatever may be the impact, whether it may permeate to the other masses, or it may permeate to the genetic sequential lineage, it may be there. That long-term pursuit is not there in science. And I want to say in nanotechnology, all nanoparticles is, you know, that our body constitute of pores. Pore is there to vaporize the body heat as well as to imbibe the essentials from outside. So it is a semi-permeable membrane when it is a physiosmotic process. And these pores, you know, that they are wider. It is like the India International Convention Center for Nanoparticles. This small pore, it is like the conventional center auditorium. Very rightly you are told, it can easily penetrate and come outside. And anyhow, all metals, God has created a natural filter in xylem and phloem vessels. Xylem and phloem vessels of the plants, they absorb the particles with malabhaga, vishabhaga, dhonabhaga. The trivial portions, the binamic portions and the wastages, they are filtered by the plants. And the same titanium, uranium, iron, calcium and whatever that you consume, if it is from a vegetative origination, that is very salubrious to us. And direct absorption at any cost, any science, except the science of contentment, peace and harmony without much of this expansion. See, that term we used to say, you are simple life theory. The theory in science is known as simple life theory. They are pessimists of technology. Pessimists of technology, they have made one theory known as simple life theory. Fuchsia of computer and brain, I told that any person being preoccupied with a computer more than a specific time, he will lose his human values and he will be a machine in disguise. Affection, love, patriotism, benevolence, amicability, forgivingness, understanding, everything you will lose. For that, I don't want them to lose the communication system. Let it develop. At least 1 or 2 hours, they must think that they are human beings and having human relations. Loss of hair, insomnia, hyperacidity, irritation, fiendishness of your face, and looking yourself as an alien for yourself in mirror, not maintaining relations with the society, the domestic community, everything will happen. You can see last of the few decades, we are seeing lot of IITians and IT persons as if they are coming out of the den after 1,000 or 2,000 years. some cave from the deep African forest they will look like. So according to simple life theory, you are given a reasonable life, a life of reasonable pleasure, happiness and prosperity. If you extend anything, you have to sacrifice some other greater valuable thing, either longevity, either your salubrity, wife's relation, kids' relation, your genetic lineage, everything is there. You have to unavoidably sacrifice these things. These things are understood only by ethical perceptions. Persons who are interested in immediate money-minting industry, getting richness and US settlement, getting flats and cars, and going with the Western community in their richness and opulential status and ostentatious behaviors, for those people, this ethical inculcation that will not work out. Their brains are sealed and no advice will get inside. Whatever you are told is correct. But I can advise, or the science community can advise, that dealing with computers, number one, the dealing with energy, the dealing with heavy craft engines and industrial developments, it can be used. And anything with the sentient imbibition, that is immediately going to give you genetic loss or characteristic loss or humanitarian value loss. They wanted to ask just only one question. And then I am going to leave. He means both of us?
The society or any person interested can be reach God or perceive God through nanotechnology.
See, God is the substratum of knowledge and power. God is the substratum of inexhaustible knowledge and power. And he is also the personification of the utmost subtlety. Nanoparticle is also certain that it has immense power inside. So through God we can understand nanotechnology. Either this nanotechnology means subtlety. Nanotechnology exists in everything, even understanding our own sukshma. Self-understanding is there. I have already told about two things. One is life technology, how to love others and how to live. So having all gadgets of life without knowing how to live, it is just like a dog playing with a pomegranate or something else. It cannot eat. So nanotechnology cannot take you to God, but nanotechnology can take you to God. If you misapply it, it can not only take you to God, it can take lot of people to God. it is not properly handled, it will create a whole rail system of compartments and engine to the divine kingdom. Nanotechnology cannot create divinity because it is understanding of matter. You see, how many idiots, they may be equal to one wise person. So I am putting 100 idiots here, that is one wise person. So if it is not there, 200 idiots, it is utterly different, because wisdom is different from idiocy. The mass can be equivalent, but not the qualitative mass. Quantitative mass can be equal. Likewise, matter at any degree of subtlety, at any degree of expansion, it cannot give God. God is not matter, He is paramaterial. So it cannot give, but God, as He is the encompasser of material, semi-material, anti-material, paramaterial, subtle material, tangible material, and all other modes of the world, He can give you knowledge about the nanomaterial if you want. But with the knowledge of, Max Planck, I told you, with the knowledge of these things, we can understand. You see, if you see a paint, that is the painter, you can understand about his face and other structures, that we can have an inference that he made paint very properly or beauteously. But if you see a painting, then only we can understand the elegance of the person's nature, his dexterity. Likewise, the more you deal with nanotechnology, you can understand how deeply the creation has been made by God. If you are already God fearing, it will make you God loving, and God provoking, it will make you to reach God.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
As a tool for testing your patience, I want to put a few words as my epilogue. When I went for this computer and brain lecture at Symbiosis Auditorium, I was talking about all parts of brain and all parts of computer, their interrelativity, convertibility, etc. And I believe that except some of the people who have the habit of just listening to me, whatever I say, irrespective of the faculty, somebody they have taken that fanaticism. So unless those people, those who have some interest with me, the other people, I have been saying that they are blinking like stars and owls. So that's how I consider for effective dissemination process. Then I gave also two humorous examples. And one thing is, somebody is very hungry and he is approaching us. I have to either give food or rice so that he can cook and eat. So I am making the person to sit and describing about agriculture, irrigation process, pesticides, other things, number one. And second thing is more humorous. Hundreds of patients, they are coming with different gifted diseases. The doctor, he has made all the patients to assemble in a common hall. And instead of asking about the diseases, he's explaining about anatomy, physiology, and comparative study between the heart of your frog and human being, etc. I myself quoted this and I gave two suggestions. Interactive session, for example, even in brain and computers. I told a very simple example, for example, let it be Jubilee Hills, 31 is post office, 32 is hotel, 33 is theater, 34 hospital. By knowing these points, we can go and get whatever the product available there, benefit available there. Likewise, I have told about the brain centers like Brodmann areas, phrenology of Joseph Hall, and Jerry Fodor's modularity of mind, everything I told. By knowing the brain centers, what you are going to, for example, somebody will be having phobia. Mechanophobia is in operation. Then communophobia is in communication. Anglophobia is in English. Chemophobia in chemistry. Arithmophobia in mathematics. Physiophobia in physics. Biophobia in biology. Everybody will be having a lot of xenophobia with the new people. And lot of other phobias, bibliophobia with books, theophobia with God and persons like me. So each and everybody will be having a deep-rooted fear. So unless we customize the questions and teaching, no doubt general lecture is required. But it must be very limited. And whatever that is applied for them and immediately getting to some sort of application, use for them, that we have to give more accentuation, that's what I felt on that day. Then I told that we can keep for 10 or 15 minutes general lecture. Then before we must give them a prior information, intimation, so that they will grab their questions and we can discuss, number one. Number two, I am taking classes, teaching chemistry, teaching physics, teaching mathematics and teaching biology. How to teach them and how to read the early syllabus. So I am going to teach at some schools at Chennai. Likewise, on this same nanophysics, I am going to teach for BA people at SNR College at Coimbatore. So I want three types of programs with anybody, generally what is it? General topic for 15 to 20 minutes. Then previous intimation to the people so that they can look other books, think and develop their own questions. And even if they may be knowing things, they can have further clarifications or they can clarify me. So they can trap these questions at present, number one. Point two, instead of talking about something like America is doing that and Italy they are researching that and Japan, Tokyo is doing that, that is just information. And for proceeding, what is this starter, where is the point of ignition? So I must deal with your syllabus. Your syllabus, you have to give a heading and your teachers are going to teach. Let me teach the same lesson in my own angle of perception, which will be deeper, I think, number two. Number three, net discussion group we can make. I am having my email ID. And whenever you have doubts, you can put your doubt. And whenever I am having my free time, I can just give you answers. And that will also improve your knowledge. And even if you are attending conferences, that will enrich you to ask more questions and to follow lectures, not only from me, and also in future lectures where you are going to attend or organize.